As a word of introduction, I would like to share with you the code Siman Tash Siman 309 Seifim Bet and Gimel number 2 and 3. I'm reading from the translation of the Mishnah Berurah to English. It is permitted to handle a basket that has a hole in it, which has been blocked by means of a stone, for the stone has become like the side of the basket. Remember what we study. Then, next, it is likewise permitted to draw water from with a pumpkin, which has a stone hung to it, to make it heavy enough to be used for drawing, provided the stone is properly tied to it so that it will not fall off, because the stone is regarded like the pumpkin itself, since it is secondary to it. However, if the stone is not properly tied to the pumpkin, it is forbidden. Remember that, because soon we're going to study that part. Then we go to the next one. If a basket is full of fruit, has a stone inside it, one may handle the basket on Shabbat as it is, without anything in it, if it contains soft fruit such as figs or grapes, that will ruin if empty out the basket. However, if it is the sort of fruit that will not get ruined, he should empty it out of the basket and empty out the stone with it as well, but should not handle the stone together with the basket and fruit. This ruling applies if one only needs the fruit or the basket, but if one needs to make use of the place where the basket is lying, he may handle the basket as it is with the stone inside it. So here the Mishnah Berurah elaborate on that, and he explained, and soon you see all the idea of Basis Ledavar Asur. The key point is the book written by Rabbi Akiva Iger, he explained all the details when and where. But let's first see the sugya itself. We are nine lines from the top of page 142. Kalkala ve'aeven betocha. The Mishnah said it is permissible to take a basket with a stone inside on Shabbat. The issue is, it may be a mukzeh, it's set aside. So, the big question is, the Tosfot deal here, and the Rabbi Kiva Iger Resu said, and the Rif, what's involved? So the Gemara said as follows. Ve'amai, why we're allowed to carry the basket? Teheve kalkala basis ledavar asur. Trace a situation. You have a candlestick, and you have a basis on the candlestick, the plate. One situation. The next situation, you have a plate that carries the candlesticks, and you have also apples. Now the question is, you want to move it for all kind of reasons. Situation one, the candlestick is at the middle of the table and it's carrying odor, or it's, you're afraid with the children, it's too dangerous, you want to move it to a different location, etc. The issue here, it's called basis ledavar asur. The foundation, it's something that you are not supposed to carry. The best example, I think, it's if you have a plate and they have a stone on a plate, okay? So now, because they have the stone, so it's a problem. If you take this basket And in a basket you have a stone, and you have also, let's say, figs. So the problem is, the stone is the foundation inside the basket. So how you can handle it? Tosfot tried to tell us that it's all kind of variation, what happened. Soon you see an example. But so far we understand we have a basket, we have a stone inside, and we have different fruits there. So the Gemara asks, it's basis ledavar asu, is the foundation. The basket should be the base of a forbidden object. So they explain, velishdin dinhu lefirei, venishdei le'evan, veninketinu beyadayim. You take the basket, you throw it to the floor, okay, or on a table, okay, and then you take with your hands the fruits that is there. Why? So even you don't carry with your hand the stones, but by the way you take the basket with the fruits, so you take out the. So they explain kederabi Eli. Amar Rav beferot ha-metunafim, achana beferot ha-metunafim. It turns that when you use it, that the fruit becomes soiled and ruined. Why? Because imagine when you're throwing out, let's say grapes or figs, you throw them to the ground. What happened? It became ruined. It's a soil. You know, it became dirty. So you cannot throw them just like that. Tosfot tells us, he asks a question. You remember we talked about the child yesterday, that the child will cry. You pick up the child and the child carry a stone and he starts crying. So Tosfot said, ואם תאמר גבי קטן נמן איש דה לאבן מידו, והמי קשר לתלתו לאמא אבן. So how come, you remember what we said yesterday? You're allowed to take the child. The child is crying, he misses daddy. So he's taking the child in his hand, even he carrying in his hand the stone. Now you tell me, if you have a basket with the stone and fruits, you cannot take the basket. How come? So the Tosfot said, ויש לומר אם השליחהו מידו יצעק התינוק ויבכה. If you if you pull out the baby and the child, and then you notice that he carry a stone and you put him back on the ground, he will scream and cry very much. Now, the truth of the matter, we have here some mornings Avi, right? So he sometimes, you know, misses daddy, so he starts crying, right? Mm-hmm. But I can attest to that I went to, over the years, to different peoples, different occasions. One time I was in Seattle, in Washington. And it was a very interesting to be by that observant family. And the child was crying, and the dad said, no, he is too spoiled, I'm not going to pay attention to him. And the mom went to some meeting or whatever, and I was there, and I couldn't sleep because this child was screaming and crying, and the dad said, let him do that. But that's unusual. Usually, the father has, say, rachmonos, has compassion. You see the child screaming, you have a choice, either to run away or to pick him up. So anyway, so they explain here, they said, so you know what? You should take, let him shake the basket with the fruit until the stone is on one side of the basket, and then you allow him to throw the stone out of the basket. So Amar Rav Chiya bar Rashi, Amar Rav, Hacha bechalkala pchuta askinan. Defen gufan aset gofen lachalkala. Beautiful. He says that you have a basket, and you have this a little hole in a basket in the bottom, and what lock that hole is the stone. So guess what's going to happen? If you move the stone, the fruits will jump out of that hole, right? And then it's like they said about the dlat, about taking the pumpkin, to fill it with the water. Remember we said what the Ran said, so the stone is very much tightly. But the Rambam in Hilchot Shabbat chapter 25 said, they're speaking about the stone that is very tight to the basket. So it's part of the basket and it's not mukze, it's not set aside. But here, the Tosfot, the second one, Benishan Dinu, there are two Tosfot. The second one said that even you are in this situation that the fruits will come out, but if you do it as a side point, which means they in a very atypical manner, so the Tosfot said, and also the Meiri, the Ritva said, he's saying that it's okay, especially if it's not fully tight to the basket. Later, when we have time, we'll go to practical halachot and we see what Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim in 309 said. So in other words, we're no longer speaking about fruits that become metunaf, soiled and ruined. We talk about baskets that have a hole with a stone there. And therefore the stone is part of the dofen, of the side of that basket. Metaltelin truma. Now the next one, the Mishnah said that you're allowed to carry truma, that it's impure, together with chulin, with the unconsecrated truma. Amar Rav Chisda lo shanu ela she torah lemata utruma utmea lemala. Aval torah lemala utmea lemata shekilu torah v'shavek letmea. All of that apply only if you have a situation that the part of the truma that you need to use is on the bottom. And therefore you have the issue and then you're allowed to carry both. But if it's the opposite, the part that is ritually pure is on the top, and on the bottom is impure. So what do? You just pick up the top and that's it. So now Gemara asks, "V'chi Torah lemata name elishnu velinkitu." So what's the big deal? Even if it's the opposite way, so let him throw out all the whole fruits out of the basket, and he should take the fruits that belong to the pure terumah, and that's it. Amar Rabbi Elah, Amar Rav, lefukot hamitanfin askinan. So he speaks about figs, about grapes, about strawberries. So if you throw it to the ground, it becomes soiled and ruined. Meiti ve'metaltelin truma temea im ha'torah v'machulin, ben she'torah lemala u'temea lemata, ben she'temea lemala u'torah lemata. So we say that regardless we can carry it, it's the different brighter. Tuvta de Rav Chisda, that's the opposite of what Rav Chisda said earlier, that it's a difference only in the bottom, not in the top. Only, in other words, only when the temea is at the bottom. Amar lach Rav Chisda, matnitin le'tzorech gufo, brighter le'tzorech mekomo. Rav Chisda said that it's a huge difference if you need the teruma. What's the purpose? If you want to, in order to eat it, so if the pure teruma, it's on the bottom, so you cannot carry both the impure with the pure. But if you need it, that you need the place that the basket was there, you need to remove it because of that place. So you need to move it, so you need it for that purpose, that's regardless, it's fine. So the Gemara asks, "Why do Hakele Rav Chisda look at Matnit L'tzorch Gufo? Why Rav Chisda impelled to establish the Mishnah as referring specifically to a case where he needs the basket for the purpose of utilizing the object itself?" So they said, "Amar Rava matnitin kvatei daika dektani seifa." It's for specific reason. Ma'ot shal akar menaer et akar vehen noflot. If you have money on the top of the pillows and you want to take the pillow, so you just move the pillow, and then the problem is, the Gemara later in the second part of the shiur explained that he needs the pillow, and he forget that he put money on the pillow. So the big question is, we don't want to have the pillow basis ledavar asur, as a base for something that is forbidden. So therefore, he needs to move it because the pillow itself is not considering a set aside, is not considering a mukze. So they said here, v'amar Rabba Bar Chana amar Rabbi Yochanan ushanu ela shletzorech gufo. So all of that apply if he needs it for what? For the purpose of he needs it for itself, which means he wants to sleep. So he doesn't want to move it. So therefore, You're not allowed to carry the pillow together with the a coin without with the money, and put it in elsewhere, because if you throw it like that, it doesn't bother him to sleep on that pillow. But if he needs that spot, which means he wants to move it because he needs that that specific spot, nothing to do with the pillow itself. So he can move the pillow while they have the coins on the top. Otherwise, he doesn't have a place to put it. Later, we go to a practical halachot. We'll show what's the halacha. Seifa letzorich gufo, reishanamei letzorich gufo. So we said, since we said that the second part, the first clause, is referring to a case when he needs the basket for the purpose of utilizing the basket. So the second one is for the basket itself. Rabbi Yehuda omer af ma'alin et hamduma be'echad ve'mea. Remember when we talk about the Mishnah, we said that Rabbi Yehuda said, why may lift the measure of truma that it's a mix of with 100 measures of non-sacred truma, like the trumat mea. So the Gemara asks, ve'amaya kametaken. Why you said it's permitted? He's rendering the produce fit for consumption. So it's forbidden to do it. Why? Because it's called tikkun kli. You're fixing the utensils, and that's the. If you remember when we studied Beya, Moran and Beitza, they said that's the reason why you cannot take a tight trumot on masrot on Shabbat. So Gemara said, Rabbi Yehuda k'Rabbi Eliezer svir alei, da'amar truma ba'einan machata, that the truma, the sacred produce, it's like its part is a separate part, is not incorporated with chulin. That none, there is a Mishnah said in Attracted Trumot, chapter 5, se'at truma shenafla lepachot mimea venidme'u. If it is se'ah of truma that fell into a less than 100 se'ah of not sacred produce, causes it to become a prohibited mixture. So they said, "V'nafal me'amduma le'makom acher." Rabbi Eliezer omer medamat ketrumat vaday. Rabbi Eliezer said that se'ah from the original mixture render a prohibited mixture the same way as that definite truma would. The mixture, it's not forbids the chulin, the non-sacred, ela lefi cheshbon. You just measure the difference accordingly, which is about 1.64 se'in. That's what Rashi said. And the Tosfot at the very end, shenafla, he said, mikan mashma letruma ola be'echad mimea ema isu. So he hold that you derive from that the truma go by 100, one of 100, but it's not like Rashi said in Chulin 99b gabei kol isurim shebatorah b'mea leperul shlato lo maskin anachi, that he said that Rashi doesn't hold this way. Anyway, as I said earlier, Rabbi Akiva Iger elaborating that especially in Trumot chapter 5 at length. So the Gemara rejected and said eimo deshamat lei lechumra lekula mishamat lei. So they said, so you see that you heard that Rabbi Eliezer expresses his opinion in a matter rule in a stringently. Did you hear him express his opinion rule in leniency? Because he's fixing the mixture. Ela hu de'amar ki Rabbi Shimon detnan. That halacha is according to what we said, Rabbi Shimon, that he said, se'ah truma shenafla le'mea ve'lo yispik le'agbiyat shenafla acheret zo asirah, ve'Rabbi Shimon matir. He said, if you have a se'ah of teruma that fell into 100 of se'ah of non-sacred produce, and he did not manage to lift the se'ah from the mixture until another se'ah of truma fell into the mixture, so the entire mixture is prohibited. That's the Rishonim hold that that's only specifically for Truma, but because it's part it's a null when it's involved with the other part, but not everyone hold that way. But here the Rabbi Shimon Matir, Rabbi Shimon permits the mixture. Rabbi Shimon hold that the first se'ah that fell into the produce, it's not mixing it, and therefore we see here that Rabbi Shimon hold that the truma, it's like it's a separate, it's a in a very lenient way. So the Gemara rejected, said to Mimai, how do you know that Rabbi Shimon hold that way? Dil mahatam ba'akam iflegeret anakam sabar afal gav denaflu bazeach hazeh keman nafal b'chadami ve'alech hamshin v'nafla ve'alech hamshin v'nafla ve'Rabbi Shimon sabar kamay tabdil b'meah v'at ibtil b'meah v'echad. So you may say that they are disagree with regard to that the two se'ar truma fell one after the other. It is though that they fell at once, and this se'ar truma fell into the 50 se'ar of non-sacred produce, and this se'ar of truma fell into 50 se'ar of not sacred produce. So Rabbi Shimon hold that the first se'ar is nullified immediately when it is to 100 of se'ar, and this se'ar will be nullified in 100 of one se'ar, which means that the second truma, it's basically it batel, that it's annulled, it's part of that. So what you see eventually, that it's forbidden to eat from that fruit until he reached them, the same measure of teruma that fell there. So if you fix that part, if you lift it up and fix that part, it's considering a tikkun, that you make it, that one does not render the rest of the mixture to feed for the consumptions. Ela hu de'amar k'Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar, the Tanya Rabbi Shimon Elazar omer, Rabbi Shimon Elazar hold that if it's a truma that mix with 100 of chulin, noten einav b'tzad zeh v'ochel mitzad acher. So he hold that, you know what, he eats from the side of the mixture and physically separate, in other words, he cast his eyes on one on this side, the mixture, and decide to separate the se'ah from the produce on that side. Which means, because they have the option to eat from that mixture by thinking, by the reflection, the thought that he have before he lift up one of the 100 of that, so therefore, even if he physically lifted up, it's not considering a tikkun. Umisavar klakvatei. So the Gemara asks, how do you know the Rabbi Yehuda hold according to the opinion? How do you know that Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar hold the same as Rabbi Yehuda? Just turn the page 142b. Ve'amiflig palig ilavei. He disagree with him and he hold that you cannot lift up the se'ah for the purpose of truma from the mixture of 101. So the Tanya, Rabbi Yehuda omer, ma'alin et hamduma b'echad b'mea. Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar omer, noten enav b'tzad zeh v'ochel mitzad acher. We just say that one may lift up the measure of teruma that was nullified from a mixture of 100 measure of non-sacred produce and mixture with the teruma. And Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar, we just said that he cast his eyes on this side, the mixture, and decided to separate the se'ah from the other side, and then he eats from a different side of the mixture. So the Gemara answered, and they said, the Rabbi Yehuda from the Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar, the rule of Rabbi Yehuda, who is the lenient, much more than Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar. Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar allowed to fix this mixture only by the reflection, the thought that you dedicate that to Ruma in advance. But you're not allowed to do it with your hands. Rabbi Yehuda hold that because you can do it by the setup, reflection, setup thought in advance, so when you do it physically, it's not considering metaken, and therefore you're allowed to lift it up, lift the se'ah even on Shabbat. Mishnah. Ha'even she'al pi achavit, Mater tzida v'inofelet. So they said, if you have a stone, it's basically mukze, it's set aside. If the stone is placed on the mouth of a barrel, let's say if you have a big barrel of wine and you want to take some wine and drink. So what happens is, if you move the barrel, what's going to happen? The stone that's on the top of the barrel is going to fall out of the barrel. So that's called tiltul min atzad, because you're moving it as an atypical manner. So the whole idea that you're allowed to do it, it's only for something that it's not mukzeh, that it's not fully set aside. For example, if he wants to take the wine from that big barrel. But if the purpose is for the stone, such as he doesn't want the stone to be stolen, etc., so you cannot move it by moving the chavit. That's the Mishnah Berurah in Shin Tet. Later we bring the practical halacha. Now, the Mishnah asks a question. Haita ben achaviyot, which means here is a situation that the stone, it's in between the barrel. So if it's between the barrel, so if the barrel was among the other barrel, and the other barrel might break the stone, follow them, so what did he do? Magbiha, he need to lift the barrel so it's separated and have some distance between that barrel and the other barrels, and then umatal tzidav inofelet, it tilts on its side, and that's in tzul min hatzad, so the stone will fall. So that's a typical situation of tiltul min hatzad. The Chazon Ish explains that that's the only way to do it properly, because then basically you move the mukzeh, you move the set aside indirectly. It's not that you intend to do today. So the whole idea of tiltul min hatzad is allowed only when the intent was for something that is permissible, such as he needs to take the wine. So his intent is not to move the stone. So that's the way most of the sages understand. But I want to see here something. 1 second. They said here the Rabbi Akiva Iger, I see here there's some comments. So Rabbi Akiva Iger, I have an issue with that. What exactly the person have an intent? So again, if we have enough time, I'll read to you something that he wrote. Ma'ot she'al akar, mena'eret akar, ve'en noflot. Remember we talked about the coin that was on a cushion? So what did he need to do? He shake the cushion, that's the rabbi said, and the coin fall. So the Gemara later explained that that's applied only when you need a pillow, you need a cushion. Haita alav lishleshet, if on the top of the pillow it was something like feces or secretions or something that it's disgusting, mekancha besmartut, you should take some one of those used towel and move it, but not water, because you're not allowed to soak any type of cloth with the water, because otherwise it's considering some derivative of kibbutz of laundering on Shabbat. And laundering, it's melaben, it's whitening. Haita shel or notnim alei mayim ad shetichle. But if it was made, the cushion was made of leather, so you don't have the issue of laundering, it's not kibbutz, it's not melaben. He places the water until the bird dung ceases, or if it's anything, it can be a secretion, so other thing that it's there, so you can take it out and find. That's what the way Rashi said. But it's important, the Shut Avdeneza and Kuf Nun Zayin said it's important to know that we're not allowed to use hands to start cleaning and fixing it and moving, scratching it. That's a rabbinic prohibition that using it in your hands is prohibited. The Bi'ur Halakha in the code elaborate on that. I wish to have more time to get there. Amar Rav Huna, Amar Rav, לא שנו אלא בשוכח, אבל במניח נעשה בסיס לדבר הראשון. Here we talk first, the Gemara, about the first idea that you have a barrel of wine and you need to move it, but you have the stone there. So that's applied, the Mishnah said, only if the one forgets the stone on the barrel. So he forgot before Shabbat, it wasn't intentional, so fine. But if someone intentionally left the stone there before Shabbat, so the barrel became the basis, the foundation, the centerpiece for something that is forbidden. So therefore, the barrel itself became a mukzeh, a set aside. So therefore, you cannot even move the barrel of wine aside in order to have the stone coming out. Now, the Mishnah said, "Hayta ben achaviyot," if it was the barrel was among the other barrels, so we say that he lifts the barrel and then he tilts it inside and the stone falls. My Tana, who is the Tana of the Mishnah that teaches? The Cholheicha deika Isura veetera veetera tarchinan beisura lo tarchinan. Who is the Tana that holds that any place that there is a prohibited item and a permitted item, one may exert ourselves for the permitted item, but we may not exert ourselves for the prohibited item. Amar Rabba Bar Chana, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Rabban Shimon Gamliel. The Tnan, we learn in Tractate Beya 14. Haborer kitnit beyom tov. If one selects a legumes on a festival, so which means he's selected the something that it's noni, the ploset, the psolet, that mixture with the other. So for example, if you have around, you have let's say a fig, and you have a small pieces of stone around the figs, and you start clean it, moving out of the fig. So what happened is, that's mukze. Why? Because as long as the small pieces of stone is at the top of the fig, even an animal cannot eat it. You need to remove those pieces of stone. So therefore, if you have legumes, and you selected during the festival, so the two issues. One issue is the selecting, which called borel. The second issue is tiltul mukze, removing something that's set aside. So Bet Shammai umrim borel, ochel veochel, which means you cannot select this part from the other part. So what do you have to do? You can do if you have three conditions. One, you need to take out the food from the psolet, from something that is no need. Number two, it needs to use your hand. You need to use your hand for the selecting. Number three, the whole purpose, we said it so many times, is for you to eat it immediately, not for something that you need later on after the holiday, but you need it right away. So, with that in mind, I want to comment that it's very important to see the full perception, to see Rabbeinu Ovadia Mebartenura, his commentary on this Mishnah, which again, you guys give me a signal of time, so I cannot go to the detail. Ubet Hillel Omrim, Borer Kedarko, Becheiko, Uvtamchui. He can do it in a regular way, or he can use his side, or you can use a big plate or big pot. Vetani amar Rabbi Shimon Gamliel b'amid v'orim ruim sha'ochel merubah al apsol v'apsol merubah al ha'ochel livra kol borer ochel. All of that apply when you have more food than all this other dirt part. But if you have more dirt than the food, so what happens is it's a great effort, it's an arduous effort to select the pieces, and therefore you selected the food, but not the psolet, because otherwise it's a issue of mukze, it's a set aside. So the Gemara asks, but here, what happened? You have this barrel of wine, and you have the stone. So what's more? it's much harder to lift up the barrel than to take the stone out from the barrel. Right? So Rabban Shimon Gamliel should hold that he should take the mukzeh, the something that's set aside, which means the stone, in order to reduce the tircha, the effort. So why the Mishnah said that he needs to lift up the barrel in order to remove the put it aside in order to throw out the stone? So the Gemara said, Achename the kiev and the ibay le mishkal, because he wants to take the wine from the barrel. Lo mishtekele ayinad shekila even, he cannot pull out the wine until he throw out the stone. So that's considered kepsolet merubah laochel. That's in equivalent to the situation that you have some solid, that some thing that you don't need for consumption, that it's more than the food itself. Hayta ben achaviyot magbiya al tzida v'inofelet. So the Mishnah said that if the barrel was among the other barrels, he lift up the barrel. Tanya Rabbi Yossi omer, hayta achavit munachat ba'otzar, o shehayu klei zchuchim munachim tachteha. מגביה למחום אחר ומטה על צידה והיא נופלת ונוטה למנה מה שצריך לו מחזירה למקומה. סורשי סד, כלומר במקום מכונס שנוצרים שם חביות הרבה ודואג שם הייתי יתלה וטיפול האבן על החלבית שאצלה. So I urge you to read in my book ואולי הכלומר ברשי על השס. I elaborate in this book the statement here in Rashi. What does that mean when he used the word כלומר and what's applied here? I give you again very much the vignette. Here he speaks about Rabbi Yossi hold if the barrel was placed in a storeroom among the other barrels, so or the glass vessel or beneath it, so he is worried that that the stone will move from that barrel, so therefore he can move it to other spot and then he put it aside and then he take what he needs. But again, the Kova Netanel wants to explain what's the difference between this bright and what we already study in the Mishnah. Then we study in the Mishnah Ma'ot She'al HaKav, if there are some coin, some money at the top of the pillow. So Amar Avchia Barashi Amar Rav Lo Shanu Ela Beshocheach Aval Bemaniach Nasel Basil Devar Asul. It's only taught in a situation that if he forget that the coin is on the pillow. But on the contrary, if he placed the coin on a pillow, so now the situation is that the pillow become a base for something that is forbidden. That's the Basil Devar Asur. Amar Bar Chanan, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, lo shelo litzor gufo litzor gufo mitzvot tovot alav. It's all applied for the purpose of utilizing it for the koshen itself, but he needed for its place. So then he can carry, move it from one place to another. וכן תנא רב חייא בר חייא רב מדיפתי לא שנו לצור גופו לצור גמור מתן לא עוד נען לב. The same he hold רב חייא בר חייא ברב מעות שעל הקר מנער. We said we'll see Mishnah that if you have a coin at the top of the pillow, so he should shake it the pillow and the coin fall. אמר רב יושע שכח רנא כבחצר. רב יושע said if you forget a purse you have a money in a courtyard on Shabbat Eve, מניח עליה כיכר או תינוק מטלטלה, he should put, place a loaf of bread or baby on it and he move it. Why? Because then the purse become a base of permitted object like the baby and then he can move it. אמר רב חיצחק שחר בלבנה בחצר מניח עליה כיכר או תינוק מטלטלה. He says if one forget a brick in a courtyard, the same story. You need to put either loaf of bread, so you need the bread, or you put the baby. So it's different story, so you can carry it, move it. אמר רב יהודה בר שלא, אמר רב אסי, פעם אחת שכחו דיסקיה מלאה מאוד בסטרטיה. It was a place called Stratia, and they forget a very large diskia, it's like saddlebag, that was a field of coin, and unfortunately it was in the main street. ובאו שאלו את רבי יוחנן. So they asked רבי יוחנן what to do. אמר להם, ואמר להם, הניחו לכיכר ותינון כתלתלוה. So it's put on the top of that big bag, a baby, or loaf of bread, and you can move it. אמר מרזוטרא, הלכה ככל הנשמת בשוכח. All of these הלכות apply only if a person forget. But you should know that if it's one did it with a full intent, so that's a different story. So you cannot use the artifice, the trick, the system, in order to have it. רב אשי אמר אפילו שכח נמי לו, ולאמור לכיכר התינוק אלא מת בלבד. Says the whole idea of allowing to use a baby or to use a loaf of bread if you have a corpse. So you need to remove the corpse, then you in a way, use some artifice to make it happen. But other than that, no, that's the Ravashi opinion. We're not yet in halacha, so don't raise your hand yet. Okay? Abaye manach kapa kife. Abaye will place a spoon on a bundle of produce so that it will be able to move the bundles because of the spoon. Rava manach sakina bar yonah umetaltela. Rava will then place a knife on a slaughter young dove and move it. So again, you talk about dead in that sense. Amar Yosef kama chariv ashmada the dardaki. Says he was like mocking them, and he said, "How sharp is halacha of these little children?" All this what Rabbanan said is applied to only if one forgets. But here you talk about that the person should do it lechatchila. What's wrong with you? Amar Abayel ilav d'adam chashuv ana kapa keif al amali. He said, "If it's not the fact that I'm meaning someone who's knowledgeable, I'll need a placed spoon on the bundles." The bundle themselves should suit it upon it. So which means that the bundle can be carried, you don't need a spoon there. The same thing, I don't need the knife on the top of the dough. I can use the dough itself suited, you can eat it as raw meat. The reason is because it's suited to eating as a person as a raw meat. But if it's not suited to as a raw meat, la, it's not. So you can move it. Which means that Rava holds the same as Rav Yehuda, that said that Shabbat is prohibited to move food that was originally designated for human consumption, and now only suited for animal consumption. He says, "You shall prepare duck for me, and we have whatever we don't eat, like the intestines. You give it to the cat." So you see, when you're taking the intestines from the duck, what you're allowed to do it in order to do what? To feed the cat. So now you think about the dog, since it's a raw meat and it's fit for the consumption of the person, but because it's suited for consumption by a dog, so you should compare it. So the Gemara said, just a few lines from 143a, Hatam kevan de masrach da'atei ilavei me'etmol. Over there, since the intestine will carry a bad smell, so if he saved them until Motzei Yom Tov, until the end of the festival, and so it's so the person have in his mind yesterday, day before, so since the Erev Shabbat, he had in mind to feed them to the cat. That was what he was thinking originally. Right? So in other words, Rava knew in advance that this intestine is not going to eat during the festival. So if he leave it after the festival, it will carry a bad smell. So he intend, that what Rashi said, in advance, to leave it for the cat. The Rashba and the Ritva said that since it was in the eve of the festival, ready for those animals, so even according to Rabbi Yehuda, he's not considering a mukta and he can carry them. And now they bring a proof. Achanam mistava de Rabbi Yehuda sviralei darash Rava ishal tiknes lebet ha'etzim liton mem ud. The woman should not go to the doing festival to a place that they have a wood, and she should not pull out a stick to move the coals. Why? Because it's mukta. And if you have that part, it's a coal that it was prepared in advance before the festival and it's broken during festival. So he said that on a festival, if you need to kindle a fire with vessel that may be moved, but not one may not kindle a fire with broken vessel that broke during the festival. Why? Because they are set aside, it's a mukta and it's forbidden. So they say Shema Mina, that here you see the conclusion from it, that from the word of the Rava, that he hold the same as Rabbi Yehuda when it's come to Alachot Mukta, which means that Rava forbids to take this wood, that this broke part from those wood part that it's intend for heating, and the same as Rabbi Yehuda in a set aside. So this the same way, he should forbid to give the cat the intestines of the duck, because it was set aside for human consumption before the festival. So it means that when he allowed to give it to a cat, it's because he have that in mind in advance before the Yom Tov took place. Practical halacha, first one is Kalkalat Pirot ve'Even Ba. Shin Tet, Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 309. On Shabbat, if a basket full of fruit has a stone inside it, and the fruit will be ruined if spilled on the ground, which means the case that we mentioned with the figs or the grape or the strawberries, so one can may lift and carry the basket with the fruit and the stone in it. On the contrary, if the fruit will not be ruined if spilled on the ground, one spill the fruit and a stone out of the basket, replace the fruit and carry the basket. On Shabbat also, when fruits lie scattered in the courtyard, one may not gather them into a basket as will do during the week. Rather, one should lift a few at a time and eat them. And a basket with a hole sealed by a stone may be carried on Shabbat because the stone is part of the side of the basket. That's the Rambam, Ilchot Shabbat, chapter 25, and Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim, 335. Now, another important halacha, we say that in Shabbat, in case where there is a stone on the top of a barrel, or coins on the top of a cushion, so one tilts the barrel and lets the stone fall, and similarly, one tilts the pillow, the cushion, and lets the coin fall. However, if the barrel was situated among other barrels, and tilting the barrel where it stands is impossible, so one may move the barrel with the stone and tilt it elsewhere. But you have to remember that all of that apply only b'shocher, that if one forget the stone is in the barrel before Shabbat. So, but if one left it there with his full intent, so then it's prohibited. Now we said also it's prohibited to clean a dirty garment with water on Shabbat due to the prohibition of laundry. Rather, one may gently wipe it with a rag, making certain not to squeeze liquid from the rag. If the garment was made of leather, it is permitted to rub it clean with the water. How about Haborer Kitniyot B'Yom Tov? One may select legumes in a typical manner on a festival by selecting the waste of the food. However, one may not do so with vessel designated for the purpose. For this purpose, if the quantity of the waste is greater than the quantity of the food, one selects the food from the waste, unless doing so require extra exertion. So that's the halacha according to Beit Hillel and Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 5:10. Tiltul letzorech mekomo. Here we're dealing with a moving for the purpose of utilizing its place. So tilting a barrel to remove a stone or shaking a cushion to move coins is permitted only in cases where one seeks to utilize the barrel or the cushion itself. On the contrary, if he seeks to utilize its place, one may move the barrel with the stone or the cushion with the coin. Now, if one must move a corpse to maintain its dignity, or if one seeks to utilize the place that the corpse is lying, he may place a loaf of bread or a baby on a corpse and move it. And this applies only to moving corpse, but not other mukze, set-aside objects that may not be moved. The last halacha of today, they say that Ud B'Yom Tov, this is Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 507 and the Rambam Ilchot Yom Tov chapter 4. On a festival, it is prohibited, the Mishnah Berurah said, to take a piece of wood, whether to damp or dry from a pile of wood and utilize it as a poker to stoke a fire in an oven. This is because it's considered as if one is completing the production process of a vessel. And again, this is Rambam Hilchot Yom Tov, chapter 4, Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim, 507. Shabbat.